Hello and good evening, everyone. Hope you're all keeping safe and healthy. Welcome to the Asia Society Hong Kong Center. My name is Slendy Budanto, and I'm an Indonesian freelance journalist who'll be moderating tonight's webinar. So what comes to your mind when you hear the word Jakarta, Indonesia's capital that's also Southeast Asia's largest city? Heavy traffic jams, floods, perhaps the prospects that the city could sink, lots of shopping malls, but what Jakarta really is? So, well, it's not really what represents the city, according to Mr. Harold van der Linde, who is the HSBC's chief Asian equity strategist and also a huge Indonesia enthusiast. He believes it's a city that's rich in culture and history. A little bit about Harold, though. So he first went to Indonesia in 1990 as his first ever backpacking trip outside of Europe. He went to Lombok in the country's West Nusa Tenggara province, and he met an Indonesian family from Jakarta. He then got inspired to learn the Indonesian language. And he also did his master's thesis in Jakarta and spent some 10 years working in the capital. 30 years later, he published a book about the city he calls home. Jakarta, History of a Misunderstood City, contains in-depth interviews that he did with three Indonesians from various age groups and backgrounds, telling the capital's history from its independence in 1945 until the modern times. And besides speaking with ordinary Indonesians, he also referred to various sources to help him complete this book. And Harold has joined us from Hong Kong, and in just a moment, he'll just tell us more about the city, basically the writing process, the research process of the book, as well as some insights that many people might not know before. He'll be sharing with us until the next 40 minutes before we continue with the Q&A session. So for those who'd like to ask Harold everything related to tonight's discussion, you can just submit your question on the Slido chat window. The event code is right there. Kindly note that a participant is only allowed to ask a question due to time limit concerns. And for now, please welcome Mr. Harold van der Linde.
Thank you very much, Randy, for this. I'm going to share my screen here now for my presentation. Here it is. So we're going to talk about Jakarta, this book I've written about the history of this misunderstood city. We're going to question why would you want to write a book really about Jakarta, a little bit how this book actually came together, what the aim of this book is. And part of it is really people that have lived in the city. So there are multiple stories of people in the book over a few centuries, but one of them I'm going to pick out and highlight a little bit. That's the story of a lady called Treintje. Then we're going to make some really big steps through Jakarta's history so that at the end of this, say, 40-minute session or so, you get a big feeling of how this city has emerged as it actually is. And we can then finish off with a couple of things about how Jakarta is now. And for most people, if you say Jakarta now, this is the picture that emerges in their mind. Endless traffic jams, in this case, rain actually a little bit as well. And if you're a business traveler to Jakarta, you stay in one of the hotels, the Mandarin, the Hyatt in the center, you go around, have a couple of meetings here and there. That is a little bit the picture that you get. But I think it's you actually miss out a lot on a lot of other things. And I'm going to tell you what you're going to miss out on and how, or maybe on the next trip, if you go there, what you can do about it as well. And I'm going to start in 1990. So on the left side, on the top, there are two pictures. On the left side, that's me in a slightly more slender version of myself. What is it now? 30 years ago. This is actually a picture taken on a small island far away off the coast of Sumatra in Nias, where I was interested to find some stuff about some old megalithic kind of society. But I was backpacking across Indonesia. And before I left for Indonesia, I had an uncle of mine who said, well, if you're going to go there, I'd suggest don't go to Jakarta. Don't finish off in Jakarta, but finish in Jakarta, but go somewhere else first. That's exactly what I did. I flew to Bali, had a couple of 1 or 2 weeks on Bali, and then made my way to eastern Indonesia across a few islands, and eventually made my way back towards Java, traveled through to Jakarta. And on one of these the ferries that I took between these islands, I stood on the ferry just looking out, and it was a 9-year-old girl that stood next to me, and she didn't feel very well. So I just gave her an aspirin and a little bit of water. She sat down, and her parents came, and we tried to chat. It didn't really work out, so we just smiled at each other. That was about it. Maybe an hour or two later, I got off the ferry, wanted to go to a bus terminal, and then a car passed by. The window was taken down, and then it was the family who was picked up by their friends. And they were going in the general same kind of direction as I was going. So they said, why don't we give you a lift? Now, their friends happened to have a small hotel in on the island there, so I could stay there. And eventually, I spent maybe 3 or 4 days with that family. Although my Indonesian was pretty bad at the time, they showed me a bit around the food, and we talked a bit and stuff like that, smoked cigarettes with them. So we became some friends, but eventually I made my move onwards to Eastern Indonesia. But they said before I left, when you get back to Jakarta, please give us a call. So 1-2 months later, I'm not quite sure, but some time later, I was in a train that hobbled into Jakarta, into Gambir Station, and checked into the backpackers lane, Jalan Jaksa in Jakarta, set myself up, had a beer, and decided to give these people a call, who were somewhat offended and said, why did you check into a room there? Check out, we'll pick you up, you're gonna stay with us. And about 2 hours later, I found myself in South Jakarta in a small kind of kampong. It looks a bit like this. So this is the picture that I have of Jakarta. It's called the Rababambu. It's in Southern Jakarta. Pasaminggu is the whole estate. And it was a very nicely tight-knit kind of community. Most people know each other. They helped each other out if things were going wrong. There's even a word for that in Indonesian called gotong royong. And they're all small alleys where people conducted their businesses and sold, fried banana in the afternoon, and somebody sold coconut cooked rice, called nasi uduk, in the morning. So it's a very nice, beautiful kind of community. I got to know the people. And the 9-year-old girl that also lived in the house would take me around to the badminton courts and show her friends and stuff like that. So I liked it actually over there. And although I initially wanted to leave and travel into Sumatra and onwards, I stayed there actually for quite some time. And I had to learn Indonesian. They didn't speak any English whatsoever. So I made a deal with them. I teach your daughter a little bit of English, but you're going to teach me Indonesian. And there I was for a couple of months. And during the day, I would simply take the bus all around Jakarta to try to explore this massive mega city that it already was in 1990, and is even much bigger than it is right now. So I took the bus around and found, of course, some of the Dutch heritage, all the buildings. You can see them, the words that they use. Some older people in those days could actually still speak some Dutch. So yeah, all kinds of Dutch connections I could find. And it was my old grandfather, who's passed away a long time ago, who said, you should actually look around and see, because I've heard that in our family, we had people there in Jakarta centuries ago. You should see if you can find something. And I had no idea where to go. So I went wrongly to the wrong place. I went to Museum National, and there was a curator there. I met him and I asked him, how do I look for that? And he says, I have no idea. We don't really have anything. So I ended up in a bit of a cul-de-sac, in a dead end, and I didn't really explore it too much further until, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 years ago, I decided to go to the National Archives. Somehow I was able to get in. I've heard that's not always easy, but I was able to get in, got access to a bunch of archives, including the city, Batavia City Archives, and went through books and books to find, if I can find somebody at least with the same surname, Van der Linde, as I had. And somewhere at the end of the first day, suddenly I found something, a Johannes van der Linde, who had lived there and died in 1742. Not only that, that guy, when he died, his family at the time made a large plaque, a wooden plaque with a family weapon on it, and sent it to a church in a city in the Netherlands called Zwolle. And it was only about a good year ago when myself and my father, you can see that picture here, went to that church and said, listen, do you have something of this Van der Linde from the 1740s or so? They said, well, we don't know, but come by in 2 days and we'll figure it out. And when we arrived, I said, yes, we still have something. We have this wooden memorial plaque that is still hanging already 250 years somewhere in the back of the church. And you can see this particular picture there. So I had a direct connection, and I know for certain that we span about, say, 10 generations. So that is a direct family member of myself. But I found, when I was in the archives, other names of other people as well. Actually, the first one that arrived in Batavia out of my family, and so far I can find that, was a lady called Barbara, who arrived 100 years before this particular man in 1650. And you gotta wonder what a lady actually was running away from to go to what was at that time really a frontier city and may try to make a little bit of a living there. But I found also records of her children and eventually connection to this particular Johannes van der Linde as well, but also people that lived in later centuries, the 18th, the 19th centuries, the 17th centuries. So yeah, I became a little bit also a Jakarta boy, anak Batawi, as they say in the city. And I felt myself directly connected to the city that I really enjoyed and lived there. So eventually I decided to actually understand the history of that city a little bit better as well, to feel where my own family members had lived and how the city was at the time. So I started to do research on the history of Jakarta, but really what is of importance when I tried to put it all together and started to think about putting a book together, I wanted not to be an academic study on the city of Jakarta. I wanted it to be a very accessible, almost a novel-like, easy readable history of Jakarta that was, of course, unlike novels, based on facts and stories that I found in the archives. And I wanted it to be centered around people. So for each individual chapter, I found one or two persons along which we try to construct a city and show how the city was in their particular lifetime. And some of these names are written down there on the side. You have this lady Trantje, we're going to talk about her in a second. There is a Jan Pondaat, who is a watchmaker. If you go through the names, there is a Balinese slave, Chindra, who had a horrendous, awful life. But eventually some people took her from the house where she was mistreated, maltreated, and took the people to court. This was our advantage. The court scribes put it all down on a piece of paper, and that is for us then to discover hundreds of years later. The problem, though, that I found is that I'm Dutch, I can read Indonesian, I can read Dutch sources as well, so I had great access, but I didn't want it to become a Dutch history of Jakarta. I needed to find other sources as well. So I tried to find other people who have been in the city and written something down, and I'll show you in a second one of them, but there were, for example, Western, but also Chinese travelers in those days, in the, even the 16th and 1700s, that ended up just going around the Indonesian archipelago and wrote down what they liked and what they saw. One of them was a Chinese guy called Ong Tae Hei. He went around the city in about 1780 and actually in quite some detail showed us how Jakarta looked like through his eyes. He had some interesting observations there as well. And in the last 50, 60 years, I decided really to talk to Indonesians that had lived there and maybe moved to Jakarta or were born there in the 1930s or 40s or 50s and see how they had lived in the city. And one of them is a man that actually was a radio broadcaster, well known in Indonesia in the 1960s and 70s, unfortunately passed away quite recently as well. But he had a fantastic story to tell because he was there, for example, in the mid-1960s when Suharto started to be able to take over power from Sukarno in those particular days. He was right there on the large square in the middle of Jakarta where actually these things were unfolding. But we got to go back to the very origins. How can we find the first evidence? Where can we find the first origins evidence that people actually lived in this particular place, what we now call the city of Jakarta? We actually can go back to Neolithic times. There are axes that have been found, but it's quite random. So we're not quite sure if these people actually lived on their own or if there were cities there. Probably the best earliest evidence that people lived in a city come from around, say, the year, say, 450-ish. And this evidence come from a couple of stones. And here is one of these stones. It's actually a replica of it. You see 2 feet. You see all kinds of sinuous curled stuff on the side. And then some writing below the feet as well. That writing, by the way, is Palawi. That is not an Indonesian language, but is an Indian language, a southern Indian language. Because a couple of hundred years before zero, so say 300-400 years before zero, Indian travelers in search of gold sailed all over the Indian Ocean to Sumatra, to Java, got context there and brought with them not only goods, but also religion, Hinduism, and script. So the Indonesians adopted that script and started to use it. So when this stone was found, they had to translate it. And it says something in Palawi that King Punavarman had constructed a canal in about 21 days, which sounds a slight exaggeration to me, but so it is. And in celebration of that, they slaughtered about 1,000 cows. Why is that then the first evidence? Well, why would you make a canal that's very large for irrigation purposes if there's not kind of a city around? Even there had to be a city around just to construct this particular canal. Now, that city was most likely located close to where the stone was found, in Bekasi, which is now East Indonesia. But actually, that although that's the first evidence, that was not where actually things started to grow. Kingdoms come, kingdoms go. That city started to kind of fade. And it was actually a small, tiny port right where Jakarta is, but on the seaside, presumably with lanky coconut palms, that port that started to grow and be of interest to people. That port was simply called Kalapa. That means coconut palm. It was kind of other kingdoms were nearby, cities were nearby, but they all used that particular port. We have some early Portuguese writing about it, but the very earliest writing about this city, although it's very little, it comes actually from an Indonesian himself, a Sundanese guy called Bujangga Manik, who traveled and walked all over Java in 1480, sailed back from a particular town in the middle of Java, and arrived in Kalapa. He doesn't write a lot about it, but he arrived there by boat. He had to register himself at presumably some kind of custom duty, made his way presumably through town. He doesn't say too much it, but he does scribe down a couple of other villages that were around. None of them we know anymore, but with the exception of one, it's called Ancol, which is now a district in North Jakarta. So again, we have kind of a local source that tells us a little bit that the city existed. Now, Kalapa was of interest to not only the people that lived there, but also to some of the other cities nearby in eastern and western, of central and western Java. And at one particular point in time, 1527, there was a fight about it. And a general came from one city, his name was Fatahila. He was able to take over control over Kalapa and renamed it. And he called it Jayakarta, which means something like a victorious city, a large city. And Jayakarta became therefore the predecessor of Jakarta. That's where the name came from. Now, Jayakarta existed for some time. It was run by a local prince under control of various kingdoms that were nearby as their power waxed and waned, you could say. But then the Europeans start to show up. Initially, the Portuguese, they are there. We know they've hammered a big stone in the ground that's later found. And they say we were here on a particular date, 1511, if I'm not mistaken. The Dutch arrived in 1595, but really established themselves a couple of years thereafter, and the English arrived as well. This became eventually a problem for the city of Jakarta. The Dutch had their warehouses there, the English wanted to build warehouses, the Portuguese actually a little bit gone by that time, but there were a city in West Java, Banten, that wanted to control it, the city itself wanted to remain independent, then there was another city, Demak, nearby, and another kingdom called Mataram. Yeah, they all wanted to have influence in this city, and that went completely horribly wrong one particular day around 1680, 1619, when the Dutch and the English started a big fight. The English actually looked like they were going to take over the control over the city. They far outnumbered the Dutch, but they started to haggle with the local force and said, yeah, it's very nice of you to kick the Dutch out. So everybody assumed that the Dutch would have been out. But if the Dutch are out, you're just going to replace them. So that's not what we want. We want to, before we're going to take this guy, we want to have some kind of agreement on what you're going to do here, what our role is going to be as well. And that agreement took so long to establish that eventually the Dutch were able to find reinforcement. And that was done by this particular kind of guy. This is a picture, Jan Pieterszoon Koen, who went all the way to the Moluccas, found some new ships, sailed back, took him about, I think about 5 months or so. And as you can see to this guy, you can find other pictures of him as well online and paintings. He never smiles. He was a harsh man. He came in and he was in no mood to negotiate with either the English or the locals. And he burned the whole city down and kicked the English out and took control over it and said, this is ours now. no negotiating here anymore. We're going to build our own city. And they named it Batavia. And that was in 1619. Well, the Batavia, we have an early map of how it looked like. This is a map from probably about 10 years thereafter, in the late 1620s. What we see here, this map looks actually from north to south. And I'm telling you this because later on I have one or two other maps and we're looking in the opposite direction. You can see the river. There's a sea at the bottom there, you could say. Then you can see the river moving in and making a big bend towards the east or towards the left for us in the top. Then there is a castle on the eastern side, so that's on the left side of the river. And beyond that castle, you see the first parts of a city that's being built with, in the very end, a little bit of a city hall that is, to a certain extent, still there or that's been rebuilt. And around the whole city, you can actually see some of these watchtowers that they built as well. On the opposite side of the river, there is nothing really there. There's a bunch of cows there and a kind of custom duty house there as well. But this is how that city looked like in around, say, 1628. Now, they needed defense because eventually we find that the Indonesians, the Mataram Empire, is going to make two large attacks on the city. And this brings us to our first story, the story I wanted to tell about this lady called Kampong. He arrived in the city when it was just being built, 1620. And you have to ask and wonder yourself, what the hell was she doing there? What was she running away from in Holland to go to this particular city and town? But there she was. She actually lived in the middle of that that town. When she arrived, she married somebody, set up a couple of plantations that were just outside of the city walls. Those were burned down when the Indonesian Mataram Empire attacked in 1628. She lost her husband as well. Remarried, wanted to remarry at some point in time, but the church didn't give her any approval for that. And therefore, she took the church and the government to court. She went to Holland for that as well. So she took him to court, and this is our advantage. The court wrote down exactly what happened, but one of the was, what have you done here in the city of the last 10 years? So she told her about the plantations, about her marriage, and how everything was burnt down, that she lost everything, and from zero started up a kind of distillery business, making kind of distillate stuff from rice wine, sold it, made a lot of money, and bought a brick house, which was proof to her that she'd done really very well, and that she's been a big contributor to the city. Unfortunately for her, it didn't really happen. And she died in the city. And this is kind of an artist's impression of that city based on some maps, including the one that we've just seen. She would have arrived here with a big Dutch ship with a red, white, and blue here, put all her stuff on some of the smaller ships that you'd see there, go into the city and start to make a living there. But this is part of an artist's rendering of that city on a computer, which I thought was nice to show. Now, that city continued to grow and actually was quite a beautiful city. This is just an illustration of this. This is one of the canals that the Dutch built. Of course, when they came here, instead of thinking about how should we build a city in a tropical climate on the coast, the Dutch just went, as they would do in Holland as well, build canals, make brick houses around it. And that would actually, over time, create a couple of problems, which we'll discuss in a few minutes or so. But this is a beautiful canal. This was prime real estate in Batavia at the time, the Tijgersgracht, which is now right in the middle of Kota. And if you would be able to look around this picture, you can see the Dutch, but Chinese. Actually, the majority of people in the town were Chinese. And there are local Indians walking around. It was actually quite a cosmopolitan kind of city at the time. Now, then we go fast forward about 30 years or so to the time that my first ancestor arrived. And the city, this is a map whereby we look from the south to the north. You can see the castle there and the rest of the city. You don't really have to go into the details, with the exception that we now see that the city expands on the west side of the river as well. So that is on the left in this particular city. And right in the middle, you see few point of Beekman's painting. That few point is a guy who sat down there and made a painting in 1651. And that painting is quite a beautiful one. And that's actually the city how it looked like when my first ancestor, Barbara, arrived here. You can see this painting here. It hangs in the Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam. Beautiful lanky palms are there. There's some houses on the left. There's a market in the front. And in the back, you can see the castle, the fort. It looks a little bit bigger, I have the impression, than it really was on the map, but so be it. And there's a river that goes straight in the middle as well. So this part where this painter stood, he was on the west side of the river, while actually the original city was on the east side of the river. The interesting thing here is a couple of people that we see on this painting. At the very bottom on the left, you can see two Chinese guys trading there. Then somewhat further, but a little bit to the right, you can see a couple that is Dutch, a Dutch man in a blue dress, dressed up very well, must have been really hot in those days, with his wife and somebody who's holding a parasol against the sun. And a little bit further, we see a guy in a striped shirt. And that was a particular guy called a Mardijk. And I'm going to zoom into this particular guy and have a picture of him enlarged right here on the left. This is a Mardijker. A Mardijker were known because they had their shirts, as you can see here, striped, and trousers as well. Very often they had bare feet, but this guy is lucky, seems to have shoes on. Mardijkers were a particular kind of people. Mardijker comes from the word merdeka, freedom in Indonesian. These were people that were freed. They were actually most often Indian slaves that were captured by the Portuguese. Eventually, the Dutch actually took control of a Portuguese city, Malacca, in 1640. A lot of these people ended up there. Because they turned and became Christians, they were freed. That's where the name Mardijker came from, and made their own living. Actually, a lot of Portuguese, after the capture of Malacca in 1640, moved from Malacca to Batavia, with the consequence that actually Portuguese was well-spoken, better spoken in those days than Dutch. Dutch actually was probably a minority language spoken only by the Dutch there. The big language there was Chinese, because the majority of people were Chinese. The Javanese had to live outside the city. The Dutch didn't want all of them inside the city walls, afraid that they might take him over. And then these Mardijkers came, and other Portuguese. And even now in the northern part of Jakarta, there's a city called the Portuguese Street. That's where most of them settled. Well, the problem was that the city was only as big as this, and if you get a lot of people going there, it becomes too small. Not only a lot of money was made those days in Batavia, so anybody who wanted to make a little bit of money in the kind of Indonesian or Southeast Asian archipelago wanted to go to Batavia. So the city was too small. Houses got really cramped, there were sometimes fires, and people had to move beyond the city walls. So therefore, the Dutch decided to come to some kind of peace agreement with Banten and Mataram, the two larger empires that were a threat to the city, and they that allowed them to build out in the areas surrounding Batavia. You can see these on the map. They set up a couple of forts, one, two, three, four, there are five forts, and there are four kind of canals that were built to those forts, and on either side of the canals they had roads and houses were built there as well. And these forts and the canals to it became kind of the skeleton of early Jakarta. The city Batavia itself, you can see at the very top, is still there. It's kind of a spider hat, but the arms of the spider are starting to stretch out east, south, southeast, and straight east. So that became kind of the sticks along which the ivy started to grow. The city started to develop. Houses were built there, but also individual people who were richer set up larger estates outside of Batavia and would spend their time there in the weekends. And on these estates, you can actually do set up markets. And where markets were people, and some of the people started to live there. Also, what you found is that aside from these estates, that people moved out of the city, but very often started to live together with people where they came from. So the Balinese had a particular area where they were all gathered together. People from Makassar had an area where they moved together. And people from other places in Java had the same. So it was all kind of segregated initially by origin, you could say. But over time, that started to melt. Now, these estates were, some of them were really big. And I have two pictures of them here. The big estate, an important estate that I'll talk about in a second as well, was called Weltevreden. That's at the north. And you can see there's a house of one guy, a governor of the Dutch East Indies Company, a massive place, plenty of room to organize a market outside. It was actually a Monday market And the area is still called Monday Market or Pasar Senen these days. And below that is an estate that actually still exists. It used to be a house also of a VOC governor, but is now a museum for the National Archives in Jakarta. It's a beautiful place to visit if you go to the city, and large grounds in the back, and kind of a nice exhibition of old archival material as well. Now, these estates and these markets, they became kind of the nodes in a network. So you had these sticks, and the ivy was growing around it, you could say, these canals, but then also outside of that, these estates where people started to hang together, and roads were built to connect them all. And from there on, you start to get a labyrinth. And that really is the old skeleton of Jakarta. So now I'm going to make a couple of big jumps through the history of the city. We're going from the 1700s now to the 1800s, because one of the issues that arose in the time that my ancestor, the first one that I found in the archives, the guy who died in 1742, and which had that large wooden plaque sent over to the Holland, he lived in 1630s and the 1730s and the 1740s there, eventually died in 1742. And two things happened in those areas. First of all, Batavia had all these canals, but they were not really well kept. The water couldn't flush through, it became stale, diseases started to go around, mosquitoes were flying into the city because of fish ponds outside of Batavia, and people got sick. It was the mysterious disease. They didn't know what malaria was at the time. We know it now, but a lot of people died. There was even big prayers on particular days to get rid of that disease. It didn't really work out. So people wanted to move out, and they moved to those areas where those estates were already built. They needed to leave. Batavia was a cesspool of diseases in, say, the 1730s and 1740s. So they moved over the next 50 years in the early 1800s further south. What also happened is actually that tension between the Dutch and the Chinese at one particular time completely exploded. And you need to read it up in the book, but I believe that one of my ancestors was probably involved with mass large-scale killings of Chinese in 1740 in Jakarta. And the Chinese were pushed out of Batavia as well, and had to set up just outside of the city in an area called Glodok, which is until now still Chinatown. The other thing that's important in these two pictures you can see, and this is around the early 1800s, is the infrastructure that they put in place. At the top, you can see a water pump that they set up in the kampongs where a lot of the locals lived. But the Dutch for themselves had some really nice tramways eventually were built. The building that you can see at the bottom there behind those trees is a building of harmony, a society where people would come together, read the newspaper, have a drink in the evening, ballroom dancing once or twice a month, and stuff like that. So the infrastructure was really beautiful as long as you belonged part of the elite. And this is important because, to a large extent, because of the lack of that infrastructure, in particular with water pumps, the majority of houses in Jakarta, even today, don't have access to piped water, but use water pumps to pump water up from the water underneath the city. And that comes from the mountains and flows down the mountains south of Jakarta towards the sea. But if you pump up enough water, then, yeah, you get that actually the whole city starts to subside and starts to sink a bit. And you get flooding issues. And if you then eventually, and this is of course in our century, start to build very heavy, large buildings on top of it, it only helps to sink that city a little bit further down. And this is one of the key problems that the city needs to overcome over the course of the next years. What then happened in the 1900s is that real proper education was set up. These are two pictures of the same building, as you can see here. This was the first gymnasium, higher education in Batavia that allowed you access to universities in the Netherlands. It was really for the Dutch elite, but to be honest, some of the Indonesian elites sent their children there as well, which must not have been easy because they were educated in Dutch and eventually went to Dutch universities, a foreign language to them to a certain extent, and were able to make it. And it's some of these Indonesians, Agus Salim, Tamrin, that came back and started to be involved with policy making. One of them came onto the city council and started to question, why are we not putting this infrastructure here? And also bigger questions, isn't this our country? What are you guys really doing here? And that comes to one of the other stories in the book as well, which I'd like to illustrate here. And we're now in the 1920s. This is a very old picture of a street in Gondangdia, which is a city part in those days southern Jakarta, but it's now central Jakarta. The trams are really important. It's actually the person that stands on the very right of that picture. There's a side road that goes in there. And on that road lived a lady and a gentleman, quite young, in the late 20s, no children yet. And she was killed by her Indonesian mate, a guy. Midan was his name, in the 1920s. And that murder case basically exploded out of proportions. People got really angry about it. How could this happen? And I think the reason why that happened, why a lot of Dutch reacted very strongly against this murder case, and there was a manhunt to get this, to nail this guy down. The reason why that happened, I think, is partially because underlying in their unconscious, in their consciousness, they started to understand that there were movements starting related to the national awakening that I mentioned earlier on. People saying, what are you really doing here? Now, the Indonesians at those particular point in time were in no position to kick the Dutch out yet. But that changed, of course, when the Second World War hit, the Japanese came in, the Dutch after the Second World War in Europe were on their knees, they were poor, the army was devastated. They couldn't really come back to Indonesia. They tried for a couple of years, but eventually in 1945, we have Sukarno declaring independence, and eventually the Dutch are kicked out of the country and Indonesia takes over itself. And the interesting thing is that, as I mentioned earlier on, we can find that last stretch of the city and the history of that city through a couple of stories of people that I've interviewed. There is, by the way, I don't have time to talk about this right here, also a great story about Deep Purple, which does the first hard rock concert in Jakarta in 1975, which goes horribly wrong. The army and the police have to come in. It's quite a funny story to read as well. But really, to a large extent, Jakarta, as we know it now, was really grew into that city after 1945, when millions and millions of Indonesians went to Jakarta because that was the place to make money. They all moved around, and therefore the people that originally lived there, the Batavi people that were the origins going back to the Mardaikas, they had over the centuries created their own identity as well. Earlier on I had a picture and I forgot to tell you, but there were two puppets behind it called Ondel Ondel, is something that's associated with them. Those came to be known as the original Jakartans, while a lot of other people after 1945 merged to Jakarta. They are kind of, say, you could say, the new ones that arrived. And we can see that if you go around the city these days, you see, and I try to illustrate this with these three pictures here, you can see Matabak, which is a pancake from the island of Bangka, which is off the coast of Sumatra. Everywhere you can see, now this name, guy's got a restaurant called named Zuria, but below it says Masakan Padang, means Padang is food. That's also Sumatran food. You can find Choto from Makassar. You can find Balinese spicy duck. You can find, and this is what the guy here makes in this two-wheel car there, Asinan, which is kind of pickles from West Java, Bogor in this case. So within Jakarta, you can see not only these beautiful kampongs, but within that, it resembles actually the whole larger archipelago of the city as well. Now, the city has some big challenges to work on. Maybe we can talk about this in the Q&A. But broadly speaking, this is the story of Jakarta. It's got my own family in there as well. Not all of them I was able to talk about. But I want to highlight this strange in the beginning in Barbara. One of my family members are in jail. Another one actually was a surgeon at a hospital. Another one was actually a successful businessman. But we also have stories of Indonesians that lived there, like the radio guy who was there in 1965 when there was a big power shift. Si Pitung, a local kind of Robin Hood in Jakarta in the 1880s, there's a story in the book as well. And we have a few other stories as well. So we try to look at this city from the way, the people saw it as it was in the past. So I'm gonna finish off here. Where you can actually get this, the book. There are multiple bookstores we have on sale in Indonesia. It's Periplus, Kinokuniya is carrying it, Amazon has it, but it takes time to deliver these things to Amazon, so unless you're in Singapore, but Amazon in the US and in the UK, take time to delivery because difficulty with container ships actually to get them over, but they have, on the website, you'll see some conservative dates where delivery dates there. If you want it faster, you can go to Asian Publisher Services, a website where you can get books in Singapore as well, and they'll mail it over to you. Or you go to Goguru in Singapore as well, Times Bookstore, which is affiliated of publisher Marshall Cavendish, who's actually done a real nice job in making this book really nice with a beautiful front cover as well. And I want to show one of these websites here as well, where you can order it. Go Google. And that is really it. So that, I thought, is about, if I'm not mistaken, about 40 minutes. I'm not bad on time, if I'm mistaken. But that is kind of the skeleton story of the book. Focus on people, trying to make it very accessible. I believe if you read it, it reads a little bit like a novel. With stories of people that lived in that beautiful city. And as I said, it's the people that make the town. And next time, if you go to Jakarta, don't just stay in a Mandarin or Hyatt and get stuck in the traffic, but take a day and walk through the small alleys, the labyrinth that are in these kampongs everywhere around Jakarta. You'll see that those people are extremely friendly, always open for a chat, and you'll make friends in no time. And with that, I'm going to stop the presentation sharing and go back to the Q&A, Randy.
Thank you so much, Harold, for the fascinating story. And we've been getting a few questions from the participants who'd like to know more about this story. So there's this one question from the person who wrote his name as anonymous, or her name as anonymous. So this person asked, what was the biggest hurdle that you found when you tried to uncover the Jakarta history? What was your biggest challenge? And since you went to Jakarta yourself to have this amazing story being told, I mean, what's the biggest challenge?
I guess the biggest challenge was not so much the history of Jakarta, but finding these stories. So I sat in archives in Indonesia, I sat in archives actually in the Netherlands as well, looked everywhere, and I wasn't always interested in the stuff that the academics would be interested in particular laws and stuff that had been written down that stipulated something, but I needed to find these stories that I could use these people around. So each of these chapters, I wanted to start with a story of a particular person. Tarantia, we spoke about, see, Peter Unger, Robin Hood. There's actually a chapter that starts with James Cook arrived in the city and didn't like it actually at all. There was a time when the city was full of diseases. So finding those stories, that took me time. It meant that you had to go through other academic research of people that found stories in the past or just through the archives themselves. And some of that, the paperwork is not always easy readable. I can read Dutch, but 16th, 17th century Dutch, I really struggle with. So I'd say there was a struggle. The other thing is, the last chapter, I wanted not only to tell the history of the city, but also look forward. So I needed to think about how the city is going to look like when my own family members, who are very young, I have a small kind of grandchild, you could almost say, he's not my grandchild, but one of my nephew's child, who is 2 years old, Darpa. And yeah, how will his city look like when he's as old as I am? So I needed to think about this as well. And for that, I just spoke with a lot of people and conducted research on the back of it. Yeah.
Right. And obviously, there's another interesting question coming from the participants. And so this person also asked, I mean, what was the most interesting discovery that you found? I mean, that you realized when you tried to find these sources in the book? Ooh. Any interesting places that no longer exist?
Yes.
Or person?
There are quite a few places. Let me do that one first. Actually, quite a few places that don't exist anymore. And even they existed. So Hotel des Indes was the prime hotel probably in Asia in the 1880s until the 1960s. It was a fantastic hotel right in the center of Jakarta. Unfortunately, it's been demolished. And there's a kind of, I don't find it very appetizing shopping mall at the moment made of glass. So it's a pity. I love those older buildings. So some of these buildings are gone. There's two interesting finds I had once. So I told you about these estates that were scattered around Batavia, and they were kind of the nodes in the labyrinth where the city started to build out. And I tried to look some of them up. And one of them is called Tanjung Timur. It's in the very south of Jakarta, not far away from Pasar Minggu. And I had read an article, somebody saying about 20 or 30 years ago that he'd seen it somewhere. So I tried to look up on maps where it should have been, and I walked around in the neighborhood, spoke with people, many people didn't know where it was until the guy was there, says, oh yeah, go through here, turn left, and you'll see something. And I found what was left of it. It was only 3-4 walls and a lot of rubbish, was pretty much gone, but one of these estates I found, so I found myself a little bit of a, kind of a Indiana Jones, you could almost say. I had a hat on as well, like, wow, I found this place, I found it very nice. The other thing that was, of course, nice for me to find was my own family members that actually had an extensive family. In my own family, we We knew a little bit about this, but we never really knew any particular details. So I found that interesting. And my uncle in the Netherlands was enthusiastic. He helped me to find all kinds of sources in Holland to corroborate some of that as well. And what it's the third thing I found interesting is actually this guy called Bujanga Manik, which I mentioned. He didn't write a lot about Kalapa and Jakarta, but he wrote actually on paper in those days. It was actually on palm leaves. He wrote his whole journey down. It's got little to do with Jakarta, but there were Indonesians who wrote this stuff down as well. Unfortunately, yeah, it was on lonta leaves. They perish over time. So there must have been a lot of other people who have done this as well in the 1480s when he did it. But that's gone, it's gone lost in history, unfortunately.
Right. All right. I want to ask you a question. Let's just talk about the present. I mean, because obviously last year, Indonesia's president Joko Widodo said that the country is going to move its capital from Jakarta to East Kalimantan. Based on your observation, really, based on your assessment, I mean, what do you make of that move? Is it the right move to begin with?
Actually, I think it is. It does mean that you take the crown of Jakarta away, but I don't think it will change Jakarta. Jakarta will, for a long time to come, be the central city in Indonesia. You can set up a city in Kalimantan, all nice and well, but where business is conducted, where the key decisions are made, will continue to be Jakarta. That's what I believe. The problem with Jakarta now, but actually, and this has always been the problem with Batavia as well, is that it was the place to make money in the archipelago. So the Dutch arrived there, and they made lots of money. Other people arrived as well, including the Maardijkers, but also the Chinese, the Balinese, and the Makassar people. And the city was too small, so they had to live on the outside. In the 1800s, again, it grew, but the infrastructure couldn't deal with it. Jakarta's always been a big magnet. Even now, people move there from all over Indonesia. And if you can find other magnets in Indonesia, then maybe people move there and that alleviates some of the pressure on Jakarta. Getting better infrastructure in Java is what Jokowi is actually doing, is one way to do that. Moving the capital to another city in Kalimantan might also, it just alleviates the pressure on this city. And the city has a couple of problems. One is there's a lot of people, the infrastructure is not enough. They're investing in the infrastructure. There's a subway now, there's a lot of more roads being built. So I think over the future it will be much better. And then of course you have that whole sinking problem. The city solves that problem itself a little bit by moving further south towards Bogor, which is higher up. But yeah, there are some proposals, for example, to put more canals into the city to direct that water, instead of having floods, but directed in proper lanes, you could say, towards the sea. So there are all kinds of ideas to deal with this. And the Jakartans should play a major role in this themselves as well.
Right. And obviously you've highlighted quite a number of problems, really. Jakarta is a giant city. It has lots of problems as well. But I wanna ask you a question that was asked from a participant as well. If you can change one thing in Jakarta, what would it be?
If I could change one thing, well, I wouldn't change the people, because I think in general, all the Jakartans, I lived there for over a decade, I know lots of people there. They shouldn't change the people, because I think they're fantastic people, very friendly, extremely hospitable. As I said, I was able to live with this family in Pasar Minggu in the 1990s. I found it difficult to believe that if this would have been the opposite way around, if Indonesia would have gone to Holland, that a Dutch family would have taken them in for months to come and be so hospitable. So it's that shouldn't change. What would be nice if basically better infrastructure could be put in place? I think better education is improving. I am a big believer in education. But if I could have one want and say you can make a nice change to the city, I would try to get some of these old buildings back. I think there are efforts by a group of Indonesians to restore the old center of Kota, the old Batavia, to its old original buildings. They're restorating it. I think that's a very noble attempt, very nice. Some people are very actively involved with it, and I met with them as well, because that's a beautiful part of the city. And it's part of our overall history, right? And then of course, as I said, like Hotel Des Indes or something like that, it would be nice to be back as well. But what the city really needs is simply better infrastructure, more subways, better roads, and maybe more canals. So if water flows around, it can actually channel the water much better than it does right now, because when the water comes from the mountains after the rain, it floods parts of the city.
Right. Right, because you earlier said that obviously the Dutch authorities have been handling the flooding for hundreds of years.
Yeah.
So, I mean, because obviously this week there has been news in the local media here that some parts of Jakarta are being flooded because of the rain coming from the neighboring cities.
Yeah.
What has changed now with regards to the handling? I mean, what would you recommend based on what you've learned from the history, the past?
Yeah. So flooding has always been a problem for Jakarta, even before the Dutch came, for the very simple reason that on one side you got big mountains, then you got the sea. The mountains bring the water down, they carry the sediment. So effectively, the northern side of Java is effectively just sediment carried from all the mountains that are in the center of Java. Yeah, and that's just not a very good place to build a city. It's swamp. And actually, Rawa is swamp in Malay. So a lot of names in Jakarta have the name Rawa and it's swamp still in it. It's just that nobody really wanted to build a 20, 30 million people city there. It was, as I said, it started off with that small Kalapa port and it just expanded over time. History just led it to this way. But yeah, you're right, the Dutch also struggled with the canals. They couldn't keep it clean. They built other canals to try to solve it. It really didn't work out. All kinds of trash. There were sugar mills in the past. They threw all their wood and stuff into the rivers that ended up in Batavia and clogged it all up. So that was always a big problem. But I'm not an engineer, and I'm not here to say this is what the city should do, right? But there are a couple of solutions that make a lot of sense to me. For example, building maybe more canals and trying to make space for it. Another interesting thing that I touch upon in the book is I've looked at the city of Rotterdam, which is also close to the sea, and what they've done in parts of Rotterdam is to build areas that are low-lying. So let's say a basketball area where people want to play basketball or soccer. You make it very low, people can play there, but if it rains and there's a flood, it can actually capture a lot of water so that the surrounding areas are not flooded, because that basketball area is like a meter lower or something like that. So there are these kind of innovations being used in other cities around the world, and maybe Jakarta should employ that as well. That's easier said than done, because there's a price tag attached to that, right? And it's easy for me to say, do that and build canals, but I don't have $50 billion ready to pay for that. So that is a limitation that you deal with. But I think ultimately, we shouldn't only look at the government. We also should look at the individual people. The Indonesians, they, as I said in the beginning, they are friendly, they work together. They live in these small kampongs. Gotong royong, if somebody's got a problem, other people will help. They do that and they can keep their own kampongs clean. And if they do that and the other ones do that as well, the city would become cleaner. They can build up some trees, make it greener. And then if some people do that and other people too, and everybody does that, the city becomes greener and cooler. And actually this is already happening. There are lots of these kind of initiatives in place around the city. So I'm actually quite positive on the future of Jakarta. There's major challenges to take, but the people that live there, they're very innovative. If there are floods, the way they deal with it is sometimes extremely ingenious and innovative. And I think they'll combined all together, there's a lot of talent there that will come up with solutions. And these solutions can all be very small, because you've got 30 million people doing that all together, then it can actually become something really big. And that's something that's being promoted actually by some architects and policymakers as well across Indonesia.
Right. And there's another interesting question coming from Miguel Sultry. I'm sorry if I'm pronouncing your name wrongly. So what has been the most enduring impact on modern Jakarta from the Dutch colonial experience, whether it's cultural or physical?
I've actually come to believe that the impact is not as big as we believe it is. The Indonesians have fostered and forged their own identity out of these Maardijkers that came. That is the Batavi culture that has influence from Chinese, from Indians, from local Indonesians. The remnants of the Dutch is really in law, in buildings, in names and language, and these kind of things. And of course, to a certain extent, the northern part of Jakarta is still has that Dutch city kind of grid and layout that they've put together. But I think the Indonesians, even around Batavia, it was actually the majority of the people that lived there were either Javanese or Chinese. The Dutch were a real minority. The Dutch language has never been enforced as much as the English did, for example, elsewhere. The Dutch actually learned Malay very much when they were policy leaders in the Dutch East Indies Company. So I don't think the Dutch maybe has had so much of an impact as some other people believe it is, simply because of the fact that arguably Batavia for a long time was actually not a Dutch city, it was a Chinese city. And the people running it were mostly Javanese. It is that they created their own culture, what we now call the Batawi culture, out of it. But the influence of the Dutch is maybe somewhat limited there.
Right. And okay, it's obvious that Indonesia will soon announce its new capital city the next decade, in the next decade or so. How do you see Jakarta's future if it no longer holds the title as of Indonesia's capital?
In Brazil, Brasilia is the capital, but it's really Rio de Janeiro, São Paulo, where the business is conducted. In Malaysia, we have the same with Jayapura and Kuala Lumpur. I think something similar will happen. So that new city will alleviate the pressure. I actually think we consider it to be a positive actually for Jakarta. As I said, it will take some of the pressures of the city. In the meantime, the existing government is trying to really, with the limited funds that they have, to tackle some massive challenges. But there is a subway now. And even 3 or 4 years ago, when the subway was built, people said, oh, nobody's going to use the subway. It's not safe. And oh, it's really bad. But now when it's there, everybody uses it. I've heard that it's almost cramped sometimes on Sundays because it's nice and cool. And it will redefine that city a little bit as well. And I think the city will continue to expand, hopefully not as fast as other parts of Java become also great places to live and that people move there instead of Jakarta. We see this already taking place. Cities outside of Jakarta grow faster than Jakarta at the moment because roads are and access there is better. But Jakarta will still be the place where you make the money, where the big decisions are made, where the big entertainment is. So this will continue to be the beating heart, I think, of Indonesia, although maybe the crown, the capital name, will go to another city. But I don't think we should be worried about that. And the reason why I also think we should be optimistic on it, and this comes back to what I said earlier on, there is a lot of Indonesians, Jakartans, that are quite innovative. You know very well, in the past, they tried to limit the amount of cars on the road with a 3-in-1. You had to be 3 people in 1 car to drive around. And that spawned a whole industry of people who rented themselves out to drive with you if you wanted to go somewhere, and you didn't have 3 people in the car, right? So you can actually take 2 people in the car, give them a bit of money, and move out. Indonesian Jakartans are very innovative with these kind of things. Also, when there are floods, they go around on boats and seem to be able to deal with it. It's a problem, but they do that in a very nice and innovative kind of way. Ingenuity is something that they have. And I think, therefore, in aggregate, all these people, they will come up with solutions to deal with this. And as I said, and all of these solutions might be small, planting some trees, keeping your own gutters clean, making sure that the road has got good access to another road of a nearby kampong, and all these kind of things. But if everybody does this, that city will continue to thrive. I have no doubt about that.
We're getting closer to the end of the discussion, Harold. One final question from me, though. Why should we get a copy of your book now and not later?
Okay. Well, first of all, because I've been talking about it, and you must be enthusiastic now to go online and buy a book. That's a very good reason. Why get a copy of it right now? The city changes. I think there will be other stories to tell in a not too distant future. Read the book now, because the next time you go to Jakarta, I know international travel is a little bit on his hand legs now, it allows you to actually then visit the city with different eyes. Maybe you go visit that old museum or some other places that have been described there. And maybe you're going to go have a walk through the city and through its kampong streets, the alleys and the alleys in that labyrinth that the whole city is. And therefore, your whole experience now will be so much different. And you want to do that now and not wait 20 years before you discover this city. There's a lot of beauty in Jakarta, but it's not easily visible. People focus on the traffic jam and the floods, but there's a lot of other beauty in there. And if you walk through these alleys, you find people that sell fried, I don't know, banana or tofu and go around and sell satay. It's all very, very nice and lively. And that is very nice. And that's the Jakarta as I know it. And I wish more people, in particular people that travel there and are not living in that city, they see that city from here on as well. And therefore, they should read it now, not to miss out on that beautiful experience.
Thank you so much, Harold van der Linde, for sharing with us everything about Jakarta. And that's it, the end of our discussion for tonight. Thank you so much for every participant and every one of you who has tuned in. And see you next time. Thanks again for watching.
Thank you, Randy. Thanks for watching. Cheers.
Thanks, Harold.